going to study memory. Okay, it's a very interesting topic, and we will be looking at that how our memory, what memory actually is, how do we process our memory, how many types of memory are there, why do we forget. Forgetting is so much common, and there are few disorders which are associated with forgetting as well, like dementia, amnesia, all these disorders come. So why we forget, actually we will study about it, and what are some noted problems with memory, how we can improve our memory. We will be studying all these today. Okay, first of all, what memory is, the definition of memory: an internal record or representation of some prior event or experience. Okay, any kind of experience or event we have gone through, we keep that events or experience record in our mind. So that internal record or representation, you can say, we call it a memory. A set of mental processes that receives, encodes, stores, organizes, alters, and retrieve information over process. This is the mental process. We will be studying it in a while in detail. Okay, so memory is the process of maintaining information over time. Memory is the means by which we draw on our past experiences in order to use this information in the present. We take things from our past learning, from past experiences, and whenever we need to talk about, we need to recall, we can easily recall information from our mind. Okay, so in the present we are talking about, or we are studying this lecture, in future it will become our memory, and that experience will become past experience. So definitely we learn from our past experiences, and memory is actually the process in which we maintain our information into our brain over the longer period of time. Okay, so what are the memory processes? Like, our human memory is like a computer which allows us to store our information for the later use. And in order to do that, we have both the computer and we need to master three processes involving in memory. First one is encoding, storing, and retrieval. What encoding is? Encoding is the information you are getting into our brains in a way that allows it to be stored. What we are taking in our brain, that is encoding. We are welcoming the memory to come into our brain. When we are welcoming, or when we are taking things from our environment, from our surroundings, that is encoding. Whereas storage is the second process, in which what we do, the information is held in a way that allows it later to be retrieved. This storage is like when you store information into your brain, and when you will be required to talk about it, to retrieve, you can easily retrieve that or recall that information. So first step is when you are taking your information from your surroundings, you are keeping it into your brain. When the keeping word comes, that there storage word comes. So keeping memory into your brain, or things into your brain, or storing that information, that is storage. After that, retrieval come, reactivating and recalling the information, producing it in a form similar to what we was encoded. Retrieval is when you need that information to recall or to retrieve back from your brain, from your mind. You can easily retrieve only by recalling the information. Okay, so what we do normally, we, for example, we are want to memorize a phone number, or what we will do, we will read the number once or twice. And we, when we are reading the somebody's mobile number, what we are doing, that we are taking that information into our brain, and after that we store that information in our brain. And when we need to recall it back, or when we are going to dial that number, so automatically we will be dialing, our fingers or our thumbs will be moving in the same order. So, or when we need to recall, we need to talk about, we can easily recall from our brain. Okay, so memory process, actually this is the memory model, you can say, processing model, which comprises of these three things: encoding, storage, and retrieval. Okay, after that there are three stages of memory. First stage is sensory memory, after that working or short-term memory, and after that long-term memory comes in. So what is sensory memory actually? Okay, for example, there is a sensory memory system in front of you, your screen. First one is you can see the environmental input. Okay, this is your environment, this is your stimulus. You are taking information from your environment. So information is coming here. Here is a sensory register, you can say. Sensory memory, memory's role or function comes here. When you are taking information from your environment, immediately it goes into your sensory register or sensory memory. What sensory memory is doing? Sensory memory quick scans for importance. Okay, those things which are important, quickly memory is scanning all of the information you are taking and pre-coding. Okay, and pre-coding is meaning it is organizing your information into your brain. After that, the second step comes, which is working or short-term memory. In short-term memory, what we do, we are coding that memory, like we have organized that, we rehearse about that information, like we repetitively we are rehearsing because we need to keep that into our mind. And recoding is again we are organizing in a proper way the way we want to keep that into our mind. And thirdly comes long-term memory. Long-term memory is, you can say, the storehouse of your brain. And this process is required for putting all the information together into your brain, or storage house, you can say, or powerhouse, you can say, your long-term memory. You keep all the necessary, unnecessary information, what you are taking from your environment, all the events, experiences which you have taken from your previously learned experiences. So those things all come into your long-term memory. Okay, so sensory memory is actually what you are taking from your environment, the quick scan. After that, working a short-term memory, short-term memory, what we need is, we need to maintain maintenance rehearsal. And how from sensory information, we are taking information to working memory. First of all, so here you can see sensory input is coming from the environmental stimuli. It's coming into sensory memory. So what happens? When we are putting attention to that information, when we are giving attention, soon after giving attention, it comes into the working or sensory short-term memory, because we are focusing on that information. So what we will do here, we will start rehearsing about it. We will repeat that number, or for example, like you are going to store that. So when you will be storing that information, it will be going into, you are rehearsing about that information. That information, after rehearsal, it will go into the long-term memory, where it will be stored throughout your lifespan. So whenever you will be needing, or whenever you get some kind of clue, your long-term memory will work, and it will retrieve information. So what long-term memory is doing? Encoding is like you are taking information in. So long-term memory is encoding information from working memory to in it, and then long-term memory is using retrieval and giving it back to sensory or short-term memory when it is required. Okay, so here, what is the sensory memory's function actually? Process for basic physical characteristics, all the characteristics, experiences, information, facts and figures, knowledge, events you are taking, all those things coming from your environment into the stimuli. So physical characters also comes in it. After that, sensory memory's capacity. Sensory memory's capacity is large. It can hold many items at once, okay? But its duration is very brief, retention of images. Like its duration is very brief. For example, 3 seconds it takes to keep information into sensory memory for visual information. 2 seconds it needs, requires to take that information in auditory form. If the information is in auditory form, you will take 2 seconds to keep that into your mind. If information is in visual form, you will be taking 3 seconds to keep that into your mind. After that, if you will not rehearse, it will be finished. But if you will be rehearsing, or you will focusing on that image, that experience for a longer period of time. After that, this information will go into your long sensory memory, and you will be rehearsing, short-term memory, you will be rehearsing that information, and it will go to long-term memory. So sensory memory's duration is very brief, okay, but it can store the larger amount of information at once. Sensory memory is divided into two types. One is iconic memory and one is echo. Iconic, you can say, are from eyes, visual information, which you can see either in form of pictures, either in form of physical characters you are watching in front of you. So all those comes into iconic memory. There is echo. Echo word means sound. So echoic memory is auditory information you are taking into your brain. So attention is needed to transfer information from your sensory memory to working memory. So how it will go? Because when you will pay focus, or when you will give attention to the information, it will move to the next stage, which is short term or working memory. So encoding memory, how capacity of short term and working memory works, and how much its capacity is. If some information is selected from sensory information to be sent to short term memory, how much information can we hold there? George Miller in 1920 proposed that we can hold 7 plus minus 2. Okay, either we can remember less than 5 or more than 5 digits. Minimum we can remember 5 digits at a time, but at maximum we can remember 9 letters. Okay, after this we cannot remember, and before less than 5 is easy. Okay, so if somebody on average, this statement comes that on the average most of the people can remember 5 to 9 letters at a time. Okay, 7 plus minus 2 is the digit. Okay, more recent research has suggested that the average person who is free from any kind of distraction can hold about 7 digits, 6 letters, or 5 words. Okay, either that individual will be able to remember 7 digits, either 6 letters, or 5 words. Okay, so working memory, which uses rehearsal, focus analysis, linking, and other processes, has greater capacity than short-term memory. We have already discussed that when we want our memory to move from sensory memory to working, we need to pay attention. When we want to move from working memory to long-term memory, we used to do rehearsal, we used to focus, we used to analyze the things, we used to make linking between the things. Okay, so we all these processes we use, and after that we take our information to our long-term memory. So this is the thing. Here is a simple test that see how many of these letters and numbers you can recall after they disappear. No need for a hyphen before the V. For example, there are a lot of words appearing in this screen. So you can, not in a sentence, but you can pick different numbers from a different line. So pick numbers, and after that, if you try to close your eyes, recall the numbers, how many letters you can recall from your mind. Try it. I'm giving it time to you. Okay, when you will be doing this, so you will be noticing that you cannot remember more than 7 or more than 9 letters and less than 5 letters. Okay, so this was our short-term or working memory. Okay, here again, it is clearly shown that when you need to take information from your environment, that is sensory memory. From sensory memory, you need attention to pay to go into the working memory. So what is long-term memory? Okay. Once information passes from sensory to working memory, it can be encoded into long-term memory. So when you are here in the working or short-term memory, when you are doing rehearsal about the things, you are focusing, you are analyzing, automatically your information is going into the long-term memory, okay? Because you are rehearsing about it, you are focusing on the information, you are giving more attention and more working, you are doing working on your memory, your event. For example, if you go to any event or a wedding, like ceremony, so what you, or birthday party, what you do? You look there, there is, you can say, a proper event is going on, you stay there for a longer period of time. So when you come back, many images, many things are coming to your visual and quick memory constantly, constantly. So after coming back from events, so automatically you recall if somebody asks you what happened there, what was the event, so you can easily recall. But after some time, for example, 1 month, 2 months later, somebody asks you, after a long period of time, somebody asks you, have you attended the birthday of that person? So immediately you recall, yes, I went there. So this was, the party was organized in that kind of manner. So automatically you are taking all of your information into your long-term memory, okay? So what are the functions of long-term memory? Long-term memory organizes and stores information, more passive form of storage than working memory. Long-term memory has unlimited capacity. You should be known that long-term memory has unlimited capacity, and it is known as the information comes here is always the permanent information which stays there for longer period of time, okay? So your long-term memory is your storage, or you can say the powerhouse of memory. Yahan tak clear hai sabko?
Yes, miss.
Okay, any questions up till now?
No, miss.
Okay, so we were talking about the long-term memory. Long-term memory organizes and stores information, more passive form of storage than working memory. So what we are doing here, automatically when we are focusing things and we are doing maintenance, rehearsal, and working memory, automatically your information is going into long-term memory. So long-term memory has unlimited capacity and its duration is permanent over there. We are talking about maintenance rehearsal. I have talked twice or thrice. What actually maintenance rehearsal means? This is a mental or verbal repetition of information. You are repeating that information, and that allows information to remain into your working memory longer than usual 30 seconds. Normally, information is staying into your working memory for 30 seconds. But if you rehearse on that mental image or verbal repetition you are doing, you are rehearsing that information will stay longer than the 30 seconds, okay? So, what are the types of long-term memory? There are two types of long-term memory. One is explicit memory and other is implicit memory. Explicit memory is declarative memory, whereas implicit memory is non-declarative memory. The explicit memory or the memory comes in the explicit memory is that kind of memory which requires our conscious recall, okay? We need to think about it and we need to consciously recall all the event or things, then we will be able to recall the image or the event. Whereas implicit memory is that which does not require our conscious recall. I mean, consciously we don't need to recall that information, okay? So in explicit memory, there are two types further comes in it. First one is episodic memory and semantic memory. Episodic memory is that memory which you can say comes because of your personal experiences. You have attended the event, you have attended the wedding, you have attended the party, you have attended any event. So you will be memorizing that because you have gained your personal experience. You went personally there and you remember because of the images that kept remaining into your mind. After that, semantic memory comes. Semantic memory is factual knowledge, okay? The factual knowledge you have, for example, about or the world, about your earth, about planets, these things are facts and figures, you can say, comes in it, okay? So these comes under semantic memory. The other is implicit memory, in which I told you about that implicit memory does not recall does not require conscious recall. So two types of memories come in the implicit memory. One is procedural memory and other is conditioning memory. Procedural memory is motor and cognitive skills involving procedures, okay? For example, those events, those things, your motor skills involved, your cognitive skills are involved, you can say those processes comes in the procedural memory, whereas conditioning memory is automatic conditioned responses. For example, you have learned that you all know about the Ivan Pavlov dogs experiment. So what happened there, that was his conditioning memory. The conditioning were there, and he learned that when he will the bell will ring, so he will be getting the food. So that was the conditioned memory, which becomes the part, which becomes parts of our memory. So here is another little explanation of explicit and implicit memories. So far we have been talking about explicit declarative memory. These are facts and experiences that we can consciously know and recall. Our minds require the information through effortful processing. Yes, when we need to recall, we need to put some effort to recall in. For example, we are studying and we make memories by studying, rehearsing, thinking, processing, then storing that information into our long-term memory. Whereas in implicit memory, some memories are formed without going through all the Atkinson and Shiffrin stages. These are implicit memories, the ones we are not fully aware of, and thus we don't declare or talk about. These memories are typically formed through automatic processing. Okay, automatically we are making this memory. We are not using any kind of process, like first of all we are encoding, then decoding, when we are taking it in sensory memory. So this information is going automatically, actually, because for example you have learned that if you will perform the good behavior, you will be getting the candy, or you will be getting a positive response from your friend or somebody to whom you were expecting, you were talking about. So what happened is that your all the information or your conditioning is becoming or going automatically through your long-term into your long-term memory. So implicit memories are formed without our awareness that we are building a memory, and without rehearsal or other processing in working memory. We don't need to that. We don't know actually that what is going on, but automatically we are doing all those processes. It is not possible that we are making our memory and we are saying that we are not encoding the information, we are not storing the information, we are not decoding. We are doing those all processes, but we are not putting conscious effort. We are not rehearsing about on that information that we want these information to keep it into your mind. And we do it unconsciously, you can say. We make our memory. So that is implicit memory. Okay. So now we will be discussing that how we can improve our memory. There are many ways by which we can improve our memory, in which first one is chunking. Chunking is, might be you are familiar with this term, chunking. Chunking means that you break the your sentence or your object or any individual digits into a smaller pieces of chunks. For example, in FSC, in chemistry, those who have studied chemistry, you know that there was, you can say, you studied the calcium, magnesium, and there was a chart in which you needed to remember all those digits or chemicals. So what you did, there were sentence I remember we made, that be much ka sar bada. This was in which we used to say that is beryllium, calcium, magnesium, these, that. So what we used to do, we used to make the chunking at that time. Okay, so organizing data, you can say, in a manageable unit. For example, there is a statement in front of you in memorize. In front you can see A, C, P, C, V, S, S, U, V. These are the letters, random letters are written. So what a person will do? You can make a small, choose small chunks from in between them. So you can remember, for example, XID, KKF, CFD. So one process will be that you will be remembering these information, or you will making chunks and non-meaningful. These are not meaningful letters. But the other thing what you can do is you can make choose that letters which has some kind of meaningful word. For example, KFC, FBI, BA, NA, CP, CDS, these kind of chunks. For example, I remember when we were young, so still we use this, that if you have to go to appear to your exam and you have a question which has a lot of headings there, So what you do, you make chunks because of those headings. Either you use every headings first letter or first 2 to 3 letters you use, and you make chunks, and then you relate those information to your individuals, like family members. Okay, if I am memorizing this, so this letter goes the like AC is my younger sister, okay, BP is my elder sister, like this. And BP was like bipolar, to remember your things into your memory. So this is the way you make your chunks into your brain, or meaningful and non-meaningful chunking we use. Okay, after that, mnemonics comes, that in it read, plane, cigar, view, shell, candy, wake, pizza, same, fire, pencil. What, which word might be easier to remember? Okay, if we will say which word is easier to remember, write down. So what you will do, we encode better with the help of images. Okay, if we will be having like you will write pizza, so you will be able to remember. So if you will be attaching that figure with the that letter with the picture, so that picture will be easier to recall or to memorize instead of the letters or words. So in pictorial forms, you remember things easily. A mnemonics is a memory trick that connects information to existing memory strengths, such as imagery or structure. So mnemonics is a strategy, you can say, or a trick of your to keep your information or to make your information strengthened by using it, by using the pictures or imagery, so that you can use. Okay, then another example is a peg word system refers to the technology of visually associated new words with an existing list that is already memorized along with numbers. For example, you can be pictured written on a door, and door equals to 4 numbers. So how you are memorizing, you attach numbers to your words or your pictures. So because of that attaching of numbers, you can easily recall your memory or your things. After that, is it clear up till now? जो हम for example कहीं पे गए हैं, कुछ हमने पढ़ा है, उसके हम rehearsal कर रहे हैं, कोई बात हमारे दिमाग में stuck कर गई है, फिर हम उस चीज के ऊपर सोचना शुरू कर देते हैं. जब हम सोचते हैं, हम efforts pay करते हैं, तो हम क्या करते हैं, हम उसके ऊपर मेहनत करते हैं. नंबर याद करना है तो उसका नंबर बार बार याद करेंगे, किसी का घर याद करना है तो उस पर एफर्ट लगाएंगे, याद कर रहे हैं. उसके बाद जब हमें रिट्रीव करना है दिमाग से, तो हम सोचेंगे, अच्छा लास्ट टाइम वहां गए थे, वहां क्या क्या था, क्या क्या था. लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल, शादी का इवेंट अटेंड किया है, कोई बर्थडे अटेंड किया, अच्छा वहां पे कर्टन्स किस रंग के थे, अच्छा वहां पे कौन कौन आया हुआ था. तो यू हैव टू थिंक अबाउट इट, और आपको एफर्ट पे करनी पड़ती है, थोड़ी सी कॉन्शियसली आपको सोचना पड़ता है मेस्ट्रो लॉन्ग और स्टोरेज हाउस से मेमोरी को निकालने के लिए. वो आपकी एक्सप्लिसिट मेमोरी होती है. इम्प्लिसिट मेमोरी वो होती है जिसमें आपको सोचना नहीं पड़ता, कोई मेहनत कॉन्शियसली नहीं करनी पड़ती. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, आप कहीं गए और उनके घर आप जो है, एक छोटी सी एग्जाम्पल देती हूँ, किस दिन किसी के घर गए और केक लेकर चले गए, उन लोगों ने आपको बहुत अच्छा वेलकम किया. किसी दिन गए तो खाली हाथ चले गए, तो वो जो जिनके घर गए उन्हें अच्छा नहीं लगा, देवर their behavior was normal. So आपने conditioning हो गई आपकी कि अच्छा जब मैं, हो सकता है उसके behind कोई भी reason हो सकती है, but आपकी conditioning हो गई कि जब मैं cake लेकर जाऊंगी तो they will be behaving nicer to me. So वो आपने condition कर लिया, आपके environment से learn किया, तो उसको आपको याद करने की जरूरत नहीं है. Next time आपने जाना है तो आपने सोचा है, यार मैंने लेकर जाना है, ठीक है. आपने क्लास में एक दफा अच्छा से परफॉर्म किया, आपने क्लास पार्टिसिपेशन अच्छी दी, अच्छा आंसर कर दिया, टीचर ने आपको बहुत अप्रिशिएट कर दिया, क्लास के सामने क्लैप करवा दिया, आपके लिए एक रीइंफोर्सर हो गया. नेक्स्ट टाइम आप कोशिश करोगे कि मैं टीचर के क्वेश्चन का आंसर दोबारा से दूं, ठीक है. तो वो जो है कि ये क्या कर रहे हो, इसमें आप ऑटोमेटिकली ये अपनी इंफॉर्मेशन बना रहे हो, एक्सपीरियंस लर्न कर रहे हो, और आप अपनी मेमोरी में भेज रहे हो. इसको मैं आपको एफर्ट लगाने की जरूरत नहीं है, तो इसके ऊपर कॉन्शियसली आपको एफर्ट नहीं. नाउ वी विल बी स्टडीइंग अबाउट फॉरगेटिंग. किस किस को इश्यू है कि चीजें भूल जाती हैं? Forgetting refers to the inability to retrieve previously stored information. Okay, so we have not previously stored that information or like so the stored information is unable to recall. For example, like I forget the password. So why I forget password of my account? Because I never try to put rehearsal on the data. I never try to put effort or revise that or rehearse that to keep that in from my sensory memory, from short-term memory to long-term memory. That is only in my sensory memory. So sensory memory's time is also already, we know that this is 2 or 3 seconds, we keep that, and after that we forget that. So because of this, we all used to forget our passwords because we don't rehearse on them. So forgetting refers to the inability to retrieve previously stored information. When you forget something, it means that it is unable to you at the time you are trying to remember it, okay? Not that it is gone forever. It is not like that, that your information is not there and it is gone forever, but it is actually unavailable at the time you need to remember. For example, in your exam, there is a question comes about which you have studied and you have done rehearsal also, but in the paper you don't remember that information, but soon after coming out of your examination hall you remember, oh my god, this was the answer. Yes, how I can forget? So that is forgetting. When at the time when you want that information to retrieve, that is unavailable. So information may be stored in your memory, but for some reason you cannot retrieve it when you want to. Forgetting is supposed to occur when the information in long-term memory decays due to passage of time or due to interference from other material or due to time elapsed, okay? So it says that forgetting occurs, that might be you are having a lot of study material you have studied, so it is inferencing with the past experience learning or the new learning, or that's why you mix up the things, you forget that information. Or because of a time, there is a longer time that you have seen that thing or you have learned about that, so you forget that. So the forgetting curve, how our forgetting curve works. A forgetting curve shows the pattern or rate and amount of forgetting that occurs over time. Generally, this curve shows that forgetting is rapid at first, then the rate of memory loss gradually decline as time passes. More than half of memory loss occurs within the first hour after learning. So here is the graph. You can see that over half of what is learned is forgotten in the first hour. Okay, this was the first hour. So you can see that half of the material you have learned is forgotten. Why? Because in sensory memory, our storage is from 2 to 3 seconds. So you forget here, okay? And after the first hour, your information retains mostly, okay? So most of what we forget, about 65% is lost in our first 8 hours. Those things which we will be not recalling or retrieval will not work in first 8 hours. After that, we will not remember that information will not go into our long-term memory. So when we need to take information into our long-term memory, we need to rehearse about that. And for example, we all forget our passwords mostly. Because why? Because we have 2 to 3 accounts or maybe 4 to 5 accounts. So all of them, we have placed the different passwords. So our passwords mix up mostly because of the new and past learning. So what we can do, we can keep one password to all the accounts so that we can remember, okay? So after that, what are the forgetting theories, okay? Theories comes, there are 4 major theories of forgetting that should be discussed in detail. First one is decay theory. Then is interference theory. Then is motivated forgetting theory. And after that, retrieval failure theory. Okay. What is decay theory? Decay theory states that time alone causes memory traces to fade. Okay. Interference theory suggests that other memories interfere with remembering. Motivated forgetting theory says that we forget information that is unpleasant or threatening to us. Retrieval failure theory says we propose that the information memory must be distorted when we attempt to recall it. Okay. Now we will be discussing all these theories in a detail. Okay. So decay theory. What is decay theory? The theory that information in memory eventually disappears if it is not assessed. Okay, if we will not retrieve information from our brain, so that information will be discarded or disappeared. We do not know whether the failure to recall sometimes reflects that there is no longer in our memory, or that it reflects retrieval failure. Perhaps it is still there, but we cannot retrieve the information for some reason. So decay is that you cannot recall that information. When you need to recall, that information disappears and it is not accessible. So there can be the two reasons: either that information is already not into our brain, or either it is into our memory but we cannot recall because of some reasons, that there is a lot of things we have to remember, or different interrelated material is in our memory, so because of that we forget. Okay, after that interference theory comes. Forgetting occurs because similar items of information interfere with one another in either storage or retrieval. The information may get into memory and stay there, but it becomes confused with other information. I have talked that when the information is interfering with each other, so because of that we forget our information. For example, proactive interference. Proactive interference is we lost our new information which we have learned. Proactive, for example, learn the list A. I have given you two lists, if I am giving. So list A is having different letters, different digits, different information, whereas list E has different knowledge. Okay, so when you will be recalling these words, you will be memorizing the list A is already what you have learned. So what you are doing right now is you are memorizing list E. So when there is a time to recall, you will forget list E, but you will be remembering list A. So previously learned things, or previous old knowledge is intact, but the new knowledge or new information is lost. This is proactive interference. Whereas retroactive interference is opposite to this. In this, you forget the old material. For example, in childhood or previously, you learned that how to count in 10 in French. That was your previous knowledge. So new knowledge is you learn how to count 10 in English. So what you will do? You will be not able to recall the old information. Like you cannot remember the things or items in French because that was your old information. So what we do mostly that in proactive, we forget our new information, okay? And like we are making passwords, we are keeping passwords, so new passwords we will be forgetting. Might be there will be one password which was old. So you will try to put that in the DS, I remember that. So when you are remembering the old thing or memorizing an old thing, you can easily record old information is not forgetted, old information is intact, but new information you cannot remember. That is proactive. When old information you forget and new information is intact, that is retroactive interference. Okay, so after that, motivated forgetting comes. Motivated forgetting arises from strong motive or desire to forget, usually because the experience is too disturbing or upsetting to remember. For example, we do tend to recall more pleasant than unpleasant things. Trauma victims do not have full memories of traumatic events. Sometimes you have to forget, you feel and remember what you deserve. Okay, so motivated forgetting is when you consciously trying to forget. That might be some unpleasant event happened to you, but you don't want to put effort, conscious effort to remember that event, to think. So you say, just leave. I don't want to talk about it. So what you are doing, you say, I forget everything. So that is your motivated forgetting. You are giving that information to your brain, to yourself, that I am forgetting the things and I don't remember anything. Actually, you don't want to remember, you don't want to recall that unpleasant events. Okay, so trauma victims, for example, they don't have full memories, they don't recall full memories of traumatic events. Okay, so that can be the reason that they don't want to recall, and they don't like, you can say that we have to forget, we feel. So at that time, what they felt was that was traumatic event. So they felt bad, miserable. So they want to forget that. So they just want to remember that what they deserve. For example, that the positivity or the positive things, or to keep them stay alive, to keep them motivated. So they try to avoid talking about those and to avoid remembering those events. So for that purpose, they try to avoid those people who ask about the trauma or bad thing happened to them. Okay. After that comes the retrieval failure theory. Okay. Why we fail information to retrieve? Okay, it refers to when we forget because we lack or fail to use the right cues or prompts to retrieve what is stored in our memory. Here it is talking about retrieval failure, says that we don't keep information or forget the right cues or prompts which helps to information to stay in or stored in our information into our memory. So we forget to use about the right cues. This theory is often referred to as cue dependent theory. Retrieval failure is dependent on cue and is useful explanation of why we sometimes fail to retrieve information even when we are sure that we know the information. Okay, in exam, when you are giving your paper, so you are trying to remember a thing but you don't remember. So what happened with you that you are sure that you know that information? Yes, you have learned about it but you don't remember. So you did not pay the attach the cue with that information. So any kind of hint, any kind of prompt you need to attach to that information, so you will be remembering. Retrieval failure is where the information is in long-term memory but cannot be accessed. Such information is said to be available, it is still stored but not accessible when you need it. It cannot be retrieved, it cannot be accessed because the retrieval cues are not present. When we store a new information, we also store new information about the situation, and they are known as retrieval cues. When we come into the same situation again, these retrieval cues can trigger the memory of the situation. For example, external or context. For example, in the environment, you went there was a specific kind of smell. So you remember that smell or you remember that place. Somebody is talking about, you remember we went last time in the park and there was a walking track was very nice over there. So you will be remembering, the park can be cue for you or the walking track can be cue for you because you walked over there. Then external context is when you are taking things or making cues from your external environment. When you are making cues from your internal environment, that is physical, emotional, mood or drunk, for example, internal cues you can attach with some kind of juice, some kind of like when I was thirsty at that time, I've taken the sugar cane juice that was too cold and I enjoyed. So you have attached the meaning when weather is too hot and I'm too thirsty, I need that juice that can help me to feel better. So you have attached the cues with that, you have attached your environment with that figure. So when you need to remember or recall information, for example, you went on a wedding ceremony and there was a function of like barat or mehndi, so what you will do that you will be remembering the event only when somebody will say, have you attended any kind of mehndi nearby? So mehndi can be the cue for you for that whole event. So you need sometimes cues to remember your information. So retrieval failure theory says that we forget things only because we don't attach cues to them, and our this theory is cue dependent. Okay, this was all about today. Let's see what we have studied. We have studied memory today, a definition of memory, how it works, how what is the process of memory. There is three processes: encoding, storage and retrieval. After that, we have discussed three stages of memory: sensory, working and long-term memory. In detail we have discussed, and we have discussed what is maintenance rehearsal. We have discussed types of long-term memories and their further types as well. And we have discussed how we can improve our memory or effortful processing strategies to improve our memory. And then we studied forgetting and its forgetting curve theories. In theories, we studied four theories: decay theory, interference theory, motivated forgetting theory, and retrieval failure theory. Okay, so I hope this is all clear.